Hello, folks. My name is Randy Lanham.
And my name is Wayne Morris. And we are so happy you are joining us on our Western Kentucky music legends, Journey to the Roots.
Wayne and I met many years ago at a local recording studio in Owensboro, Kentucky, and became instant friends.
And shortly after, we started volunteering together at the hospital, Wendell Foster, and hospice. Me, being mostly a gospel singer, and Randy, playing mostly bluegrass and mountain music, started to share our music with each other.
Since then, almost 15 years later, we still love to volunteer with our music, but have also found a love for local music legends and their musical influence, not only local, but worldwide.
We are so proud of our musical heritage that we wanted to share it with you. Along with our musical journey, we played some of their songs and heard from local historians to tell their story. We thought it might be fun to take our friends Chris Joslin, Chris Armstrong, Brian Snyder, and Troy Sexton along and film our experience.
So we stopped at some of the most influential places these icons wrote and sang about, and where some are laid to rest.
We hope you enjoy the video and even take the trip to experience the sound and places where this music was created.
We started in Owensboro, Kentucky at the Bluegrass Music Hall of Fame and Museum. I have the great pleasure of being the education director there. Here is a video that explains all about the Bluegrass Music Hall of Fame and Museum and their mission to remember the past and to grow the future of bluegrass music.
The Bluegrass Music Hall of Fame Museum, certainly the thing that energizes everything we do is the music. It's about the music. But I like to refer to it as music with a mission. Music with a mission in the sense that it's not just about entertainment. Certainly there's plenty of that, whether it's at Romp or here at our, in our Woodward Theater or on our outdoor stage. But really what we're trying to encourage is engagement around the music, engagement around the cultural heritage of bluegrass music, because it's uniquely Kentucky.
Really our goal is just to educate people around this area about bluegrass music. You know, Bill Monroe, born and raised right down the road in Roseville, Kentucky. Bluegrass music that is popular literally all over the entire world comes from this area. We feel like it's very important that people not only be introduced to it, but learn about it.
It's more than just music, it's that, but it's also about the music, about gathering, preserving, exhibiting the history of bluegrass music, but then helping current and future generations understand why it's relevant, how they can engage.
Well, Romp is our biggest fundraiser, and it's even though it's the huge festival, and it's really what the community sees, but the whole purpose of that is so that we can have funding for our educational programming, which is about the preservation of the bluegrass music genre.
I get the great pleasure of doing the bluegrass in the schools. So what that entails of is me going into the classrooms, taking either fiddle, mandolin, guitar, or banjo, work directly with the music teacher and get to go into the classrooms, put the instruments in the kids' hands and get to spend about a week or so giving them an introduction of that instrument.
It's a gateway to getting students to know about that connection to Western Kentucky and the history and the culture and the tradition of the music. And that really, it develops an interest with the students. And many times they'll go home, tell their parents about what's going on. They may end up coming to actually visit the museum just because somebody went in and told them about what's going on. They may end up here as part of a tour group, or they may decide that they just loved it so much they want to take a lesson on the Saturday morning lessons.
When they experience playing an instrument in the schools, some kids really, they're curious to want to know more. They want to hear more about it. They want to potentially even learn to play an instrument. These programs are all connected and all support each other and dovetail really well. Whether it is our Bluegrass in the Schools program or Saturday lessons or open jam, one of those programs is called the Bluegrass Band Project, where we bring musicians together in a group, we all learn a common repertoire, and then we break into smaller, manageable groups, and we coach these individuals in terms of not just the arrangement, but how you interact as a band. And it's great because it's just another outlet for these musicians who want to learn, who want to develop, to plug in.
Hello, my name is Mackenzie Bell, and I play the fiddle. I play in the band Ever City Strings that was created by the Bluegrass Band Project here at the museum. Playing with a band and the making the wave of playing by myself and then playing with a whole band, it took a little time because I had to learn that I wasn't just the one playing. Other people were playing, I had to let other people play too. And it was changing, but I got used to it. And now it's just the funnest time that I have ever had.
Chris Joslin and Randy Lanham had a vision for spreading the joy of bluegrass music throughout the community in Western Kentucky, Owensboro, and surrounding areas. So our River City Strings band is one of the bands that has persevered over the last 2 years. And we've grown together musically, and we have enjoyed spreading the joy and serving the community in this fashion.
We've partnered with another local nonprofit called Volunteer Owensboro. They exist to help people who want to volunteer for a nonprofit to connect with the right nonprofit. So once we coach and nurture these folks in a band context, then we create opportunities, identify opportunities, and help them find a place to serve. I think music stirs something in people that's really unique, and it's sometimes hard to explain. So you think about folks who are in an assisted living situation, or in a nursing home, or hospice, or in other areas that they can't get to the music, but you bring it to them, you can play songs that really stir things in them, stir emotions, and help them engage cognitively in a way that maybe they don't have other opportunities like that. So I love the fact that the Bluegrass Band Project has a dual purpose and is far-reaching in terms of the people who participate and the community it serves. For those who are considering getting involved, you know, perhaps as a member, or if it's a donor who has a real heart for a specific program like Bluegrass in the Schools or our free instrument loan program, I think there are plenty of opportunities and avenues for those folks to kind of come alongside our mission and to partner with us. And really what that does is it helps us have an impact. And I think at the end of the day, that's what it's all about, is to have an impact on individuals and have an impact on communities. And so we couldn't accomplish what we do and make it accessible to people without a lot of partners who come alongside us. So that's definitely key. And we're so fortunate that we have a lot of people that have a natural interest in what we're doing and see the value in that and want to be a part of it.
Before we start on our musical journey, let's play the song Mama Don't Allow at the Bluegrass Music Hall of Fame and Museum so you can hear all of us jam a little to get this journey started.
Woo!
let's head just a few miles down the road to Rosine, Kentucky, where the father of bluegrass music, Bill Monroe, grew up. We will learn about Bill, hear his story, and see some of the places and people that influenced him.
It was such an honor to be able to play in some of these places.
Very happy to have you here at the Bill Monroe Museum. We opened in April of 2018, and it was a long time coming, but it's finally here, and we're receiving guests from all over. We're just really glad you're here. The museum was a long time coming, and it was pictured actually when they restored the home place back in 2001. They bought all of Bill's last memorabilia, and it was stored for a while, but when the museum was finally built, it is about 99% of all Bill's memorabilia and his awards and things that people used to love to give him too. Now James, his son, does like the museum, and he has brought some items to be in the museum too that were his parents and some of his mother's things. Many of our things are of gifts from Bill. We have the highlight of his last car that he drove and was chauffeured up into in 1996, right before his passing actually. So one of our highlights are the mandolins that are behind me, because those were made with wood from the home place. So they have some of that extra little green in them that was made from the coloring of the home place when it was restored. One thing that the guests really like is the heritage tree on the back wall. They like to look at, of course, Bill was the youngest of six children, and they like to see how that heritage went out. One interesting fact that I find is that with all of those children, only Bill and Speed had grandchildren for his mom and dad. And everybody is surprised when they come in about how laid back Bill really was. When they walk through the museum and they see the furniture that he had, it's like, well, we expected, I don't know if they expected chrome and diamonds or what, but Bill remained very, very true to his roots, and that's what's really depicted in the museum. One of the things that people like to see or they ask about when they come to the museum is, don't you have any pictures of Bill as a young boy or growing up here in Rosine? But you have to remember, Bill was just a child growing up here. When he moved into the home place, he was 7 years old, and he left the home place and lived with Uncle Penn in his cabin for about a year after his parents died. He left here when he was age 17, and back then they didn't take pictures like they take now. Plus, he wasn't famous when he left. So it just makes it a little bit different that we catch his career later on. But the home place is especially an awesome place for people to visit. It's, I'd like to call it it's almost the Memphis for bluegrass music. I've actually seen people kiss the ground when they get there. It's on many, many people's bucket lists, and they want to see the home place. So the restoring in 2001 just was an awesome effort by a company out of Nashville. They were able to preserve 70% of the natural wood. So when you're there, you can tell that the wood is a little altered in places and things, and the floors are new, but the chimney and the fireplace are the original. So it gives you that real home feeling, and you know why Bill loved it and recorded so much about Jerusalem Ridge and his home place.
Now, Bill grew up next to a place known as Jerusalem Ridge and wrote this instrumental tune about it. Here's our version of Jerusalem Ridge played inside of Bill's childhood home.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, boys. Well,
I liked it.
Good.
Break down.
All right, bring in the real band.
When you visit the home place, you see some of the original artifacts that were purchased back in 2000 with the memorabilia. And then it is staged to look almost exactly like it looked when Bill was in there. His actual bedroom was a breezeway in the original plan, but Bill was only 7 when they moved in, so Marissa wanted him closer to her, so you'll have the girls' room, the parents' room, and then that breezeway area, which is Bill's tiny little bedroom, because at the age of 7, she wanted him up close to her. So, there's the original artifacts of some of the stove that heated the boys' room. Melissa's ironing board is there. And I think that's kind of a special treat, because one of the things that Bill is known for is when he performed, they were always classy. They dressed good, they had the hats, they had the boots, and it might have been from all those hours that Melissa spent on that ironing board dressing her children when they were young.
Bill would often visit the old home place when he got older and wrote songs about remembering the good times but missing his mother and father. Here's our version of I'm On My Way Back to the Old Home.
So Bill went to church at the Methodist Church, and that is also where they had his funeral when he came to Rosine to lay in rest. The church is basically, it has new pews, but otherwise it looks the same as it looked when Bill was there.
Bill always loved his church and gospel music. He always played gospel at his live shows and wrote and recorded many gospel songs throughout the years. It's obvious that the Rosine Methodist Church made a big impact on his life. And that very place is where he was saved by grace. Here's a song that he wrote about that experience, entitled Little Community Church House.
Gospel song, I went inside to kneel and pray. Oh,
awesome. Yeah. Bird singing in the background.
Yeah.
Cat went by. Yeah. Did you get a shot of B-roll of the horses?
Yeah. Oh.
And when they had the funeral there, it was standing room only in the yard, and many famous people came and visited. And James let the funeral go on for several hours. I know that I've heard stories where the funeral man asked, "Can we? You know, how long do you want this to run? Should we shut it down?" And James said, "No, we will keep it going until every last person has had a time to say goodbye to my dad." So, and then they hand carried the casket from the church to the cemetery, and the processional went right down the street, and they hand carried Bill to the Rosine Cemetery. So when you visit the Rosine Cemetery, Bill's monument is obvious. It's a nice, big, perfect tribute to the man. There's some benches you can stay and visit with him for a while. And his monument was presented by James Monroe. But when you're there, you'll notice that all his family is buried around him. The only people that are not buried there are his wife, Carolyn, and his daughter, Melissa. They are in Nashville. But the rest of the family is all there. You'll see Birch, Harry, Speed. And then you need to walk straight across the cemetery, and in the front row is Uncle Penn. And Uncle Penn's monument was erected by Bill. And he lovingly inscripted all the words to Uncle Penn on it.
Bill loved Rosine so much that he wanted to be buried there next to his family. We thought it would be nice to pay tribute to Bill by playing his most famous song, Blue Moon of Kentucky, at his gravesite.
Blue moon of Kentucky, keep on shining. Shine on the one that's gone and proved and true. Blue moon of Kentucky, keep on shining. The one that's gone and left me blue. It was on a moonlit night, the stars were shining bright. They whispered from on high, your love to say goodbye. Blue moon of Kentucky, keep on shining.
Uncle Penn's cabin is also here. So when Bill's parents died, first his mother passed away and then his dad passed. So after they passed, Uncle Penn came to the home and lived for about a year with Bill, but he didn't like that. He wanted to go back to his cabin. So he and Bill moved back to Uncle Penn's cabin. James Monroe rebuilt the Uncle Penn's cabin. It's about 90% what it would have looked like, but it does have new lumber. And it has many, many artifacts of the Monroe family and of Bill's and Uncle Penn's in it. The amazing thing is it's on the original land, so it is high on the hill. And when you go to the back porch, you can see how the music would have carried down to through the hill. And people that live in Rosine say, yes, you really could tell when Penn was on his porch playing his fiddle.
It is well known that Bill's uncle, Pendleton Vandiver, was a huge influence on him. So much that he wrote this famous song called Uncle Penn. It was really an honor to be able to perform this on the back porch of Penn's cabin.
1, 2, 3, 4.
ring. You can hear it talk, you can hear it sing. Lordy, how it ring. You can hear it talk, you can hear it sing. You can hear it talk, you can hear it sing. Play the fiddle, Lordy, how it ring. You can hear it talk, you can hear it sing.
So when you come to Rosine, you actually start learning all about bluegrass. You'll start with the home place, see where Bill was born. You'll go to the gravesite to see where he lays to rest. You'll come to the museum to see all his history and learn more about Bill. And then you'll go to Uncle Penn's cabin and visit there. And actually, Uncle Penn's cabin, James likes to say, I think that's where bluegrass was born, because Bill contributes his sense of rhythm to playing with Uncle Penn. And he and Penn would travel around in the wagon and play for barn dances, for weddings, and Bill started playing a lot when he started traveling with Penn and his group. So then to carry out the tradition, on Friday nights, we have free bluegrass music at the Rosine Barn. And we're very proud of our barn. It started out small in a little store and grew till they finally opened the barn and had a place to play bluegrass music. In 2016, the barn was awarded one of the best 52 places to visit in the world by the New York Times, and we're pretty proud of that. And it does make a difference. You can see people from France, Germany, all over, because when they come over for a holiday, they have a month. And to come to the barn, if it's 200 miles away, we're going, because it's a famous place to visit, and it's always a good time. We have a county website, which is visitohiocountyky.com. Plus, all of our venues here that are open to visitors have Facebook pages. And everyone likes to post, and we encourage you to come and visit, take your picture, and post those on your pages, and the word just gets out, because Rosine is the place in Ohio County is the home of bluegrass music.
Now we will travel just a little bit south to Morgantown, Kentucky, to hear about Arnold Shultz. Arnold was an African-American musician that grew up around this area and influenced many musicians.
Well, Arnold was born over in Ohio County in the Prentice community, right close to Cromwell. And he spent most of his life there working in coal mines and playing music at night. And he didn't spend a lot of time in Butler County, but I'm thinking probably a year or a little more than a year. He's listed in the 1930 census as living in Butler County, had a rented house. And so he died here in April of 1931. In reading and studying about Arnold Shultz and what a great musician he must have been. Everybody you read about says he's just the best there was. And talking to local people who knew him, they would agree with that too, that they just never heard anybody like him. But anyway, in taking all that into consideration, to me it's an honor to have this marker to him here. I'm so glad we got it, because before this, he was in an unmarked grave here in this cemetery, which, as you can see, most of the graves here are unmarked. But I just appreciate knowing that the contributions he made to the music in all genres of music, really, even rock and roll, he kind of influenced that to some small degree. He played with a couple of local musicians, a guy by the name of Wade Sutton and another man by the name of Beecher Carson. The three of them played. They didn't really have a band, but they would just go around the county and play at barn dances and other venues like that. Probably when Bill Monroe was about 10 or 12 years old, he started listening to Arnold, and I think Arnold was playing in a band with Bill's Uncle Penn, Van Diver, and got to listening to him there and was wanting to play a guitar himself, and just watched Arnold's licks, I guess, on the guitar and picked them up as he went, and had a huge influence on Bill Monroe's music, from what I understand.
All right, how about we play a little bit of Soldier's Joy, boys? I know Arnold played a lot of square dances, and I'm sure he played this one at some of them square dances.
Yeah.
Dedicated this marker here in 1994. Some of his family, there were about 100 people at the dedication, and some of us were his family members. One was spoke to the group and saying that Arnold was kind of a drifter, that he'd take off and maybe go to St. Louis or New Orleans. So I'm thinking that's where he picked up his blues style music and passed it on to Bill Monroe. It was really impressive how much Arnold Shultz has influenced the styles of music around the nation, and particularly in the blues and bluegrass. He played some, I think, with Kennedy Jones, and I think he passed that on to Kennedy Jones, and Jones in turn taught Mose Rager, and Mose Rager taught Chet Atkins, and the Everly Brothers, Ike Everly.
Arnold influenced a lot of musicians in the area, Although he is not credited for creating thumb picking, many people believe he did have an influence on it. We wanted to pay tribute to Arnold by playing the Cannonball Rag. Now we're going to head a little northwest to Muhlenberg County and learn about their rich musical heritage.
And we'll hear some songs and learn about John Prine, Merle Travis, and the Everly Brothers.
We're located 200 North First Street, Central City, Kentucky. The official title of the building is Muhlenberg County Music Museum. We are fortunate to be able to house our music heritage here, which reaches back a number of years and across a number of artists and a number of different, you know, types of music. And so we are pleased that people are coming to visit us. Actually, we've now had over the last 5 or 6 years guests from 49 states. Only Hawaii has not had someone to come yet. We're working on that, in fact, and 18 different countries. And so the appeal of our music goes around the nation and around the world, and we're awfully proud to share that with people. So if you're listening to this, you have an opportunity to be in our neck of the woods, come and see us. We'll be happy to accommodate you. The whole idea for the museum came back actually in 1988. There was a homecoming event for the Everly Brothers, and they came back to a parade and a family reunion and a closing concert. Don was actually born here. Phil was born in Chicago, but the brothers grew up mostly in Shenandoah, Iowa. And although they did not grow up in the community, this was still their home base. Grandparents, both sides of the family, aunts, uncles, cousins, you know, all of those relatives were here. So they spent lots of time here growing up and still called it home. So the homecoming event was a very good success. The closing concert at the end of the day drew 5,000 people. It was such a nice event for our community and for the brothers and their families. The idea was to repeat that if we could. That turned out to be 15 years worth of repeats. So from 1988 to 2002, every year, Labor Day weekend except for two of those years, the brothers came and hosted and brought lots and played and brought lots of entertainment to our community. The list of stars that were here is amazing. People we never would have had an opportunity to be able to host in our community, you know, otherwise.
All I Have to Do Is Dream has always been one of our favorite Everly Brothers songs. Whenever we perform it, it's always fun to see folks singing along.
When I want you in my arms. Thank you.
One of the regular guests at those concerts was John Prine. He was here for about half of them. And always a special treat when the brothers, John Prine, were both here, they would close the show by singing Paradise on stage together, which was really a treat. So the idea of doing a museum began back in those days, and then rather than simply honor the Everly Brothers, we recognized that our music heritage went beyond that to include Merle Travis and John Prine and even a world-renowned flutist named Jim Walker. We are also not only home of the Everly Brothers, but home of the legends of thumb picking. And there are four individuals that actually track that from Muhlenberg County to make it go all over the world. It's interesting that the style started, as I am told, from a mother, Alice DeArmond Jones, teaching her son Kennedy how to play guitar in that style. I can't imagine people even walking and chewing gum at the same time. And these folks, with all that's going on, and you know, the style of guitar playing is thumb playing rhythm and bass, fingers playing melody and harmony, and left hand playing chords. And all that going on while they're talking and singing and cutting up, it's just amazing to me. So the mother teaches her son. He expands the art. Kennedy Jones was given credit for actually originating the art from his mother. From there, others saw that they wanted to do it too. So first, Mose Rager, a local barber who became a standard actually in the Grand Ole Opry, and Ike Everly, father of the Everly Brothers, they learned how to thumb pick a guitar actually from Kennedy Jones. And then the two of them influenced Merle Travis on how to play guitar in that fashion. Probably, you know, Mose maybe a little more than Ike at that point, but Merle Travis gave both of them credit for teaching him how to play guitar. And then Merle Travis took it out of the county. And so his success first in Cincinnati and maybe Chicago, and then Nashville, and finally on to Los Angeles. And he heavily influenced Chet Atkins in how to play guitar that way. So with Chet Atkins, of course, it's gone everywhere. Even today, one of the probably most famous guitarists in the world, Tommy Emmanuel, he gives Merle Travis credit for that style of guitar playing, which is really neat for us. At one point, it had been said that Arnold Shultz taught Kennedy Jones, you know, how to play guitar. He denied that. You know, he played guitar his style, but he was influenced, I think, by the blues, jazzy side of what Arnold Shultz had done. Apparently, Arnold Shultz had some experience down around New Orleans, you know, and just, you know, on with that exposure, you know, his style of guitar playing was a little bit unique. So I think Kennedy Jones was influenced by it and, like, built it into his style, you know, but everybody's taken a little bit different. You know, they say even the way Merle Travis, you know, played thumb picking was different than Kennedy Jones and different than Mose Rager and different than Ike Everly and that sort of thing. And I'm also told that Don Everly was a tremendous guitarist, did not get credit. I mean, their vocals were so nice. He didn't get credit for his guitar playing, but apparently he was, you know, a student of the thumb picking style of guitar playing as well. So it had far-reaching impact, for sure.
The next song coming up was so much fun for us to play. It's called The Guitar Rag. Merle Travis wrote the words to this instrumental about one of his guitar heroes, Mose Rager.
Actually, Merle Travis Music Center and Paradise Park are side by side. The Merle Travis Music Center is a small performing arts center, seats about 300 people, but there's a really nice display for Merle Travis in that building. Nice glass display, his costuming from the days when he was, you know, so popular, as well as his guitars are on display. They're really neat. Then next door to that in Paradise Park, a lot of still tribute to Merle Travis and to thumb picking. His Boyhood Home is located there. The Thumb Picker Hall of Fame is located there as well. There is an old general store that mimicked or is much like what the company stores would have been back in the coal mining days. You know, just I've been told, and this certainly makes sense to me, that a large part of the music heritage in our county goes back to the coal mining days. Apparently these folks, they mined during the day. That was their job. In the evenings, they were together on porches and they would sing and play, and everybody played something. So it really, you know, kind of created the potential to develop that style is the thing. Yes, just Ike Everly is buried locally in Rose Hill Cemetery, and a portion of Phil's ashes are buried there as well. Merle Travis is buried in Ebenezer Baptist Cemetery. That is kind of midway between Greenville and Drakesboro. He's buried there. Mose Rager is buried in that cemetery as well. And then one other feature in that area, the legends of thumb picking are celebrated in Drakesboro. There is a nice tribute, a fountain that's across from City Hall. And in addition to honoring those four guitarists, again, Kennedy Jones, Mose Rager, Ike Everly, and Merle Travis, in addition to honoring them, there are historical type markers there that feature, you know, Mose Rager, who lived right across the street from the monument, then also the legends in general. And that's in Drakesboro, Kentucky, about 7 miles from here. John Prine's story is similar to the brothers, you know, in that he wasn't raised in this community, but he was close enough, tight enough, that it was a very special place for him. His parents were born and raised in Paradise, Kentucky, which is a small mining town, you know, in Muhlenberg County. And the story that he, you know, he tells in the song Paradise is pretty much true in terms of what happened with that. When TVA came to town in order to make electricity, they needed coal reserves, they needed space. So they located the power plant near Paradise, Kentucky. So sure enough, that town, you know, disappeared. So John Prine was there often enough, you know, as a kid. Again, his parents and grandparents were there, so he was back visiting enough that that community was very special to him. So he wrote the song Paradise, as I understand, in order to pay tribute to his heritage, and then also as somewhat of a protest against what strip mining was doing to the lands at that time. You know, not long after that is when the Reclamation Act, you know, came around, and certainly those areas now look very nice. I mean, as nice as they ever did. But in those days, a lot of strip pits, a lot of spoil banks, it just wasn't very attractive. But John Prine, again, had those strong connections here. And I am told that, I mean, even through those concert years, through 2002, there was a Prine family reunion in the county every year. He attended all of those. And so still has lots of his cousins around, and they stay close, or did stay close until this passing. And so he was very close to our community. And then, as I mentioned, we were doing those concerts. John Prine actually attended performed at 8 of those 15 concerts for us. You know, I'm told this is factual. We were not made aware of it. You know, the family is pretty private, and I think they wanted to honor what John Prine had requested in the song Paradise. And so I am told that Phil and his wife, and at least one of the sons, they simply showed up, you know, one day at Rochester Dam. And they spread a portion of his ashes, you know, in Green River, Rochester Dam, in order to fulfill, you know, the lyrics to the song. So there was nothing, I think, recorded about that. It was a very private, you know, event. Just they did that on their own. But I am 99% certain that is true.
Many people love to hear Paradise by John Prine. We always have requests to play it at shows. It was really cool to be able to play this at the Green River with the Rochester Dam behind us. The water was so high that day you couldn't see it, but it was there.
2, 3, 4. When I was a child, my family would travel down to Western Kentucky, where my parents were born. There's a backwards old town. Often remind
like snakes and we'd shoot with our pistols, but empty pop bottles was all we would kill. But Daddy, won't you take me back to Muhlenberg County, down by the Green River where paradise lay? Well, I'm sorry, son, but you're too late in asking. Mr. Peabody's cold train.
Merle Travis, you know, just, you know, he is known as certainly a singer, songwriter, you know, guitarist, and even actor. And Merle Travis was born and raised, you know, here and left the area then with an opportunity to expand, you know, his career. But his music, probably the most famous song for him, there were a number of coal mining songs, but 16 Tons was a song that he actually wrote and recorded. And although it was not as huge for him as it was for Tennessee Ernie Ford a few years later, you know, he was the writer of that song.
We absolutely love playing this next song called 16 Tons, written by Merle Travis. There's a part in the song that talks about the company store. My wife's family is from Muhlenberg County, and her granddads on both sides of the family worked in those coal mines that he sings about. My daughter now sleeps on a bed that came from the company store. Here's our version of 16 Tons.
Thank you. holiday, older and deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, 'cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store.
Other coal mining songs like Dark as a Dungeon, 9-Pound Hammer, you know, those songs were really good songs that were copied by other people as well. So he had a great career in terms of singing, in terms of writing, that sort of thing. But his guitar playing is probably the thing that he is most famous for us. I mean, having taken that thumb-picking style of guitar playing out of the county and getting to Nashville and for Chet Atkins to pick up on it and to tie into it and kind of model after it a little bit as well, you know, that is an incredible testimony to his talent. And near the end of his career, actually, he and Chet Atkins, you know, did a tour together, and it was kind of a traveling show where the two of them were good friends and, you know, and played guitar together and really enjoyed that time together. What people don't know about him is his acting days. You know, after he left Nashville and went to Los Angeles, he was involved in B-Western movies, you know, during that time. He'd befriended Gene Autry and played in a number of those, and then even finally his probably greatest movie accomplishment was in From Here to Eternity. He played a GI and sang a song, Reenlistment Blues, in that movie. And that was probably his biggest acting success was there. I wanted to be able to tell our music heritage in a complete and factual and consistent way. So we developed documentaries, actually, to tell the careers of the four people that I had named and then their connection to our community. Everything in this part of the museum is all about Muhlenberg County music. Everything here has some tie to Muhlenberg County.
We hope you had a good time going with us on our journey today. We hope that you will take the trip and see for yourself all the great musical culture and history we have in our area.
We're going to head back to Owensboro now to the Bluegrass Music Hall of Fame and Museum and play one more song. My granddad John Lanham always told me to keep the old music alive and to pass it down. We want to encourage you to help with that and teach the younger generation from who and where it all came from. So, will the circle be unbroken, or will you help us keep that music alive?
Let's do it. 1, 2, 3.
Wayne, we sure did have a good time on this project, didn't we?
Man, we sure did. And we want to thank you for joining us on our Western Kentucky Music Legends Journey to the Roots.